Good morning. Welcome to Wichita Bible Church. We are delighted that you're here. We're all excited to be here. I want to ask you to stand with me. I'm going to read just a few verses of scripture, then we're going to pray to get started here. Why don't you go ahead and stand? Psalm 113. Praise the Lord. Praise, O servants of the Lord. Praise the name of the Lord. Let the name of the Lord be praised, both now and forevermore. From the rising of the sun to the place where it sets, the name of the Lord is to be praised. The Lord is exalted over all the nations, his glory above the heavens. Who is like the Lord our God, the one who sits enthroned on high, who stoops down to look on the heavens and the earth? So we're going to have many opportunities, reasons from all the things that we see and hear this morning to be praising God as we listen to the word taught and share our lives together as we sing together. So join with me in just a moment of prayer. Father, we are indeed grateful to you. You are worthy of our praise. I just pray, Father, that as we contemplate you and your person and your works this morning, that you would fill our hearts with a genuine, sincere praise for you. As we sing, as we hear your word, as we talk with one another, that you would be exalted, that we make much of you this morning in our hearts and with our time together. And we pray in Christ's name. Amen.
Love that will not let Well, good morning again. Good to see all of you here this morning. Just want to highlight a couple announcements, actually one in particular. A lot of things going on this month. A lot of them are towards the end of the month, so be sure and keep your bulletin and be apprised of what's coming up. But I do want to highlight the youth minister candidates are all scheduled to come. The first one is coming on March 19th, 20th and 21st. So again, this is all in your bulletin. Be sure and look at those and really go to the Lord in prayer over those. We want to get God's candidate here to minister alongside us and with our youth and children and stuff. So very important to be going to the prayer in that. You all probably know and remember that there was about seven or eight of us from the church this last week that went to the Shepherd's Conference. A couple guys from other churches did join us, so we had a group of about eight or nine or ten, something like that. But anyway, it was a wonderful time. I would probably describe it as a mountaintop experience. I don't think I'm glowing this morning, but I am in my heart for sure. But anyway, we're going to have Marshall and Charles come up at this time and just share their thoughts on briefly on the time this that we had this past week. So Charles and Marshall, if you want to come on up and share your thoughts on that, encourage us with some words.
I'm going to make Marshall go first.
Can I pass this off to you again? Or sure. No. I was hoping to have something written up. I didn't. I remembered that I have kids. It was a time of, refreshment. I think that's what came to mind at first, and then what I was able to witness at this conference was, I think what also came to mind was servanthood, not just with John MacArthur and the speakers, but the how many thousands of volunteers that were there. If you're unfamiliar with this conference, Shepherd's Conference, it's particularly pastors. I think there was, from what I understand, over 5,000 men that came to this conference to be grown in Christ by each other and by particular speakers. There was about five different speeches or preaching and or teaching that was going on every day. It was about 8 to 8 o'clock, I think, and so it was a busy day, not including the eating that we did, which I did gain about 5 pounds, I think. I told my wife before I left, I'm going to lose 5 pounds, and I gained probably double that. But So going back to that point, I was very impressed with this church in particular that came to serve, both in teaching but also in the amenities, and it was something that was very well thought out, which convicted me to, okay, what am I doing at this church or the local church? How are we individually doing that to serve? And so that was something that came across. What little I did write down, the singing was incredible. I think I had heard that at my old church, Pastor Doug's church down in GCC. It's hard to describe, and I hope they have it on MP3 or something that you'd be able to listen to later along with the stream. The best I could describe is what I imagine. And I think I heard it described as what heaven was going to be like. Over 5,000 men singing about the glory of Christ. Except, I knew it wasn't heaven because we didn't have the tenderness of women singing. It was just a bunch of men, and the roof was about to explode. But so I think that will hopefully balance that out. But if you haven't, I guess what I would also say, if you haven't gone, I would commend it to you men that regardless if you're a pastor or not, that it was a blessing to be with these other men from the church. We met others that were not of our church, and grew in a relationship with them. It was well worth it, regardless of the sacrifice of time or money. It was something that will benefit you and your family.
So the theme of the conference was Truth Remains, and as you can imagine, a lot of the, well, all the messages had something to do with how the truth triumphs in different areas of the Christian life, or how it triumphs in theologically in areas that we study in the Scripture. So the anthem throughout the week was the truth and the hope that we have as Christians that the truth will win in the end. And one of the things that Marshall highlighted that is just a good illustration of that is the camaraderie that you always feel at a conference like this. I mean, you know, most of these guys that come, the 5,000 or so guys that come, are probably coming from decent or good churches where they feel that kind of kindred spirit of conviction. But when you assemble like this, you feel less alone in the world about the truth. And that is always, I mean, every year, that's probably the biggest takeaway for me is just kind of the strength of camaraderie, knowing that people around the world literally have the same convictions you do. And while you always feel small in number as a Christian, there's great power in that fellowship of getting around a theme like that. And not only hearing preaching and teaching about the truth, but conversations that kind of flow out of that. And then, of course, the music. And I'll give you one example that was probably the most powerful for me, and probably, I would guess, maybe all of our guys, too, was the very last part of the conference. They did something they've never done before, quite like this. And they told us ahead of time in the last session, they said, we're gonna have everybody. Oh, I should probably back up and give you a fact. So the conference had like 5,500 men, but the sanctuary only seats about 3,000 or so. So most of us, including our entire group, were sitting in overflow areas on other parts of the campus, different rooms and buildings. And so we weren't ever all together like in one place until the last song after MacArthur preached the last message. They told us ahead of time, we're going to have all of you guys come into the auditorium with us. And we'll let you know, just come on in. And I immediately thought fire marshals when I heard, like, oh man, because I know what that auditorium looks like. And so, yeah, that's what happened. They made an announcement on the streaming service, and we from all other places of the campus started making our way to the auditorium. And if you guys know the song "Is He Worthy" that Andrew Peterson wrote, that was the song they were gonna have us all sing together. And as we were walking to the auditorium, they started the song, which was actually really neat to hear it already being sung as we were entering the auditorium, the other 2,000 of us. And we just kind of filled in aisles in the auditorium, and it was just packed. I mean, there's just guys everywhere in there singing "Is He Worthy," and with the echoes and the congregational response parts of that song, if you know that song. And it was a very moving, but again, kind of the highlight of what I'm trying to say. We are not alone as people who love the truth. And singing together at that moment was not just an emotional highlight, but it was just very stimulating spiritually to look around the auditorium and see guys singing at the top of their voices that they love the Lord Jesus Christ, and He's the only one worthy. And we followed up with "He Will Hold Me Fast," which was the closing song of the entire conference, and that was equally moving. So I would echo what Art Marshall said. It is a really unique conference. I go to many different kinds of conferences, and this is a unique one. This isn't like the others. You men have given the opportunity in years to come. I would encourage you to save and put away your pennies for it, because you will not regret it. It's well worth the trip and the investment. So good week. God was good.
Thank you, Marshall and Charles. I would just echo that as well. The singing is absolutely, you can't describe it. And certainly that last few minutes of the conference, when all 5,500 were in one place singing to God's glory, is was breathtaking, to say the least. So anyway, pray with me as I ask God's blessing on our time here this morning. Father God, we are truly, truly blessed that you have called us to know you, that you have given us your word, which is truth, the only truth. There is no other truth, Father. You have made that so clear to us this past week. You have given us your Holy Spirit to enlighten us and teach us and draw us and convict us. And you've given us your amazing Son who allows us and calls us to be a child of yours, to have all our sins forgiven for all eternity, and to live in your presence, not only in the future when we're glorified, but even now. Father, thank you for the truth that you have given us. Thank you that we can come here this morning to worship in truth so that we then can obey in truth. And that will cause us to walk in the truth and to rejoice in the truth and to love one another in the truth. Thank you, Father, for this time together that we can open your word and again hear this truth. I pray for Brother Grady as he comes to us and speaks to us the truth of your word. Father, give him a strong voice. Give him clear thoughts as he's prepared to share what you've given him this morning with us. We praise you. We thank you. We acknowledge you're our God. In Christ's precious name, amen.
Let's stand as we continue singing.
Strength, my song is called.
seated. Well, good morning, everybody. I want to share a quick story with you guys. About a month ago, I started preparing the sermon for today. 2 weeks ago, I realized I had skipped over the last part of Colossians 1 and jumped into Colossians 2. And so I went, what am I going to do? So had to start over again, but at least I'm prepared for the next time I get up here and speak. What I want to do today is look at Colossians 1, 24 through 29, and would like to start with a quick review, an outline of this chapter, so to speak. So in Colossians 1, verses 1 and 2, basically Paul introduces himself to the Colossians, because he had never seen them face to face, so he writes them this letter, and he introduces himself. In verses 3 through 8, Paul encourages the Colossian people, especially for their faith that was being well known throughout the world at that time. 9 through 14, Paul prays for the Colossians. And we'll look at a little part of that later on. And then in 15 through 20, he spends time telling us who Jesus is and why he is supreme over everybody. Then in 21 through 23, talks about Jesus as our reconciler of all things to God. And today we're going to look at Paul's ministry and some of the things about Paul. So we're going to look at his suffering for the church, his stewardship to the church, the great mystery he was given to unveil, and his goal to present everyone mature in Christ. Let's read the passage that we're going to be talking about today. You can read along on the screen, or you can read in your Bible. Verse 24, "Now I rejoice in my sufferings for your sake, and in my flesh I am filling up what is lacking in Christ's afflictions for the sake of his body, that is, the church, of which I became a minister according to the stewardship from God that was given to me for you to make the word of God fully known. The mystery hidden for ages and generations, but now revealed to his saints, to them God chose to make known how great among the Gentiles are the riches of the glory of this mystery, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. Him we proclaim, warning everyone, teaching everyone with all wisdom, that we may present everyone mature in Christ. For this I toil, struggling with all his energy that he powerfully works within me." So now I rejoice in my sufferings for your sake. Paul ended the previous session with verse 23. It reads, "If indeed you continue in the faith, stable and steadfast, not shifting from the hope of the gospel that you heard, which has been proclaimed in all creation under heaven, and of which I, Paul, became a minister. In Acts 9, when Paul is on the road to Damascus, and he's blinded, Jesus goes to Ananias and says, go to this man and proclaim the gospel to him, basically. And Ananias doesn't want to go. But in that passage, there was something that I'd never seen before. Jesus says, I want to go to him, for he must know how much he will suffer for the kingdom. That's a paraphrase. But that's the gist. So I want to take a look at Paul's life. In Philippians 3, Paul's talking about, if you want to compare your flesh to my flesh, here are some things to consider. Paul was circumcised on the eighth day. He was born into the tribe of Benjamin. He calls himself a Hebrew of Hebrews. He was trained by the Pharisees. He was zealous in persecuting the church. And he was blameless concerning the law. In Acts 9:1 and a few verses following, Paul asks the high priest for written permission to bind Christians and take them to Jerusalem. He was called by Jesus to become an apostle. Jews and Gentiles sought to kill him. Currently, he's in jail in Rome, and that's part of his suffering. During his ministry, here are a few of the things he endured. Paul had experienced being the persecutor and being the persecuted, which not many of us probably were involved with. I don't know of anyone here that was a persecutor of the church before they got saved. I know there are some men in our society today, Josh McDowell and Lee Strobel, who were both in law school that set out to prove that Christianity was wrong. And in the course of their studies, they both found the gospel to be true and became Christians and worked in ministries for many, many years. Here are a few things, few more things about Paul. Out of 2 Corinthians 11, Paul says, three times I was beaten with rods, once I was stoned, three times I was shipwrecked, a night and a day I was adrift at sea, on frequent journeys, in danger from rivers, dangers from robbers, dangers from my own people, danger from Gentiles, danger in the city, danger in the wilderness, danger in the sea, danger from false brothers. What a pleasant life to live. Who would want to live that life? Who would want to be persecuted that much? Well, Paul does, and not only does he enjoy, here's a few more things about Paul's, let me back up. Danger from false brothers, in toil and hardship through many a sleepless night, in hunger and thirst, often without food, in cold and exposure. And apart from other things, there is the daily pressure of me, on me, of my anxiety for all the churches. I never remember reading this last sentence about pressure on me of my anxiety for all the churches. Paul had in him a great desire to serve the church. And we'll see a little later that that's his calling. Why did Paul endure all of the hardships? Why would someone put themselves through grueling adversity again and again? Paul's answer is simple. He's doing it for you, Colossians, but in overall, he's doing it for the entire church. He is doing it because it's part of Christ's commission to preach to the Gentiles. That is why he is glad to do it. More than that, he rejoices in doing it. I think about all those things that he went through. And how can you rejoice unless you know God is with you, God is leading you, God is guiding you, and God is the one working through you? Let's talk a little bit more about this. In verse 24, now I rejoice in my sufferings. I rejoice in my sufferings for your sake. And in my flesh, I am filling what is lacking in Christ's afflictions for the sake of his body, that is the church. One thing we need to see here is Paul has kind of taken up where, if I can say this, Christ left off. Christ established the church. Christ died, rose again, came back, showed himself to the disciples, and ascended into heaven where he waits now. Now, Paul is the one that's the main target of the Jews and the Gentiles alike. We know that the apostles also experienced some of this persecution, and many of them died horrific deaths. Have you ever noticed that once a leader of a movement is taken care of or nullified, the next step for the enemy is to move to destroy the followers? Jew and Gentile both wanted to destroy Christianity. All of his bodily afflictions, all of Paul's bodily afflictions were an attack on Jesus and were aimed at destroying the church. If you can destroy the leadership, you can destroy a movement. But there's something about this Christianity that's different because it's not controlled by man. It's controlled by Jesus. When the Christ's enemies had gotten their fill of inflicting injury on him, so now they've turned their hatred on those who preach the gospel. It was in that sense that Paul filled up. Paul knew from the beginning that he was to suffer, and it came quickly. Within days, Jewish leaders were trying to destroy him, trying to kill him. Verse 25. Of which I became a minister according to the stewardship from God that was given to me for you, to make the word of God fully known. He says in verse 25 that his commission came from God himself, and you can see that in Acts 9 on the Damascus Road. Changed everything for Paul. He now became a steward or a slave who now managed the church, so to speak, for Christ. A steward is a slave who usually manages his master's household, dispensing resources, handling business and financial affairs. Paul viewed his ministry as a stewardship from the Lord. The church is God's household, and Paul was given the task of caring for, feeding, and leading the churches, for which he was accountable to God. Daily he worked at communicating the gospel. That was what God called him to do. Verse 26, the mystery hidden for ages and generations, but now revealed to his saints. The mystery is no longer hidden. It's now been revealed that all who believe, even the Gentiles, are included. He designed the gospel should be preached to the Gentiles. In accordance with that arrangement, he has called Paul to be a minister. Paul preached to both Gentiles and Jews, but we know his main call was to preach to the Gentiles. So what is this great mystery? Ephesians 3:6 says this, this mystery is that the Gentile are fellow heirs, members of the same body, and partakers of the promise in Christ Jesus through the gospel. This mystery that the Gentiles are now members of the body was foreign to the Jews and unknown to Gentiles. This mystery was being revealed. There are a lot of false teachers in the area that were teaching their own mysteries, trying to entice people to move away from Christianity and move back into mysticism and so forth. But Paul qualifies this term as a secret which has been revealed by God to the entire church. It is an open secret that God has chosen to dwell in the hearts of Gentiles. Mysteries, once revealed, are plain and simple. The Jewish mysteries were, there was always something new being added to it. It couldn't be explained easily, but Paul states it very, very plainly in Ephesians. In verse 27, to them God chose to make known how great among the Gentiles are the riches of the glory of this mystery, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. It was always God's plan to dwell among his people. In fact, one of his names means Emmanuel. Emmanuel means God with us. Today, he dwells in everyone who believes what Christ has done for them. Ezekiel 36 says this, and I will give you a new heart and a new spirit I will put within you, and I will remove the heart of stone from your flesh and give you a heart of flesh. And I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes and be careful to obey my rules. Ezekiel's saying, this heart of stone is going to be taken away. And that's good for everybody, not just the Jews now, but the Gentiles also. In Colossians 1:28, it says, him we proclaim. This Jesus is the one who he proclaims, warning everyone and teaching everyone with all wisdom, that he may present everyone mature in Christ. Once again, he brings up the concept that we are in Christ. He also wants us to know nothing but Christ alone. From this passage also, we gather a definition of true wisdom, that by which we are presented perfect in the sight of God, and that in Christ and nowhere else. So what does it mean, warning and teaching everyone? Warning could also be translated as admonishing, and this word literally means to straighten out one's thinking. It's a matter of correcting where someone has gone wrong. Use the illustration of a ship or a plane. If it's traveling a long distance, it's at the right starting point. But if it gets off 1 or 2 degrees, it's never going to make the destination where it was going. It's going to be off course and going to be lost. And so we always have to admonish one another that we're on the right track, that we're following Christ. The word teaching is more of a positive side. It is about presenting truths about God, the world, and the way of faith as they have never been revealed, of course. But it can never be just that. There will be aspects that stretch minds, but it should always profoundly affect hearts and impact lives. We are not aiming at information transfer, but life transformation through encountering Christ. I want to go back to Colossians 1:9 and show one thing that Paul prayed for the Colossians. And so, from the day we heard, we have not ceased to pray for you, asking that you may be filled with the knowledge of his will in all spiritual wisdom and understanding, so as to walk in a manner worthy of the Lord, fully pleasing him, bearing fruit in every good work, and increasing in the knowledge of God. Back up in verse 9 where it says that asking that you may be filled with the knowledge of his will. That filled is overflowing. It's filled to the brim. There's no more room for anything else to put in it. And Paul is wanting them to have that complete knowledge and wisdom and understanding about who he is. It's important that we make sure we preach the true Jesus. We can't preach a false Jesus. But just like in Paul's days, there were false prophets and teachers, so in our day, there are false prophets and false teachers. So we need to warn against these types, different types of Christ. The Christ who makes you rich when you sow a seed of faith and donate to one of his preachers. When I was in seminary, one of my fellow classmates used to go through the checkout stand, and there may be something there for Bedwetters of America or something like that. And he would make up a name and put my address on it. And so I started getting all this bedwetting information. One of the other things that he did, I don't know if Robert Tilton is still around. He is. He put my name on a sign-up sheet for Robert Tilton. So every month, I would get something new from Robert Tilton. And the name he used for me was Cadorley Dankplank. So that was my name. And I'd get all this stuff. One month, I'd get a cloth that I could pray on and send it back to him with money. And then they would pray over it. Next month, I'd get a little piece of wood that was part of the cross. I pray over that, and I'm supposed to send it back in. Then I got a little bitty pebble, which is my stone to slay Goliath. This went on for like a year until I moved to Kansas. But we have to make sure we're preaching the right Jesus, the Christ who cures sickness when required, but conveniently minds his own business the rest of the time. How many of you call on Christ only when you need him? Only follow him only when he's going to do something for you? Or the Christ found in holy places, which are not even necessarily Christian holy places, but which bring tranquility or a sense of belonging, or in spiritual movements, such as the liver shiver. I'm not sure what the liver shiver is, but a few years ago, there was a group going around, and they were, it said in one scripture that Jesus laughed. So they had this not out of the body experience, but they started laughing uncontrollably, and that was part of their knowing who God was or whatever. I think the liver shiver is the dancing that they do in some Pentecostal churches. And then there are the more political Christ, like the one who is a courageous defender of family values and their upholders, while there is another who sides with the oppressed poor, regardless of who is doing the oppressing or the behavior of the oppressed. How do you know you're following the right Jesus? How do you know you're staying on path? What is it that keeps you going? Matthew 28 tells us we're supposed to go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And behold, I am with you always, teaching every man. Paul makes it his business to instruct every man, as well as to exhort them. Exhortation and warning are of little use when there is no sound instruction. And a careful incalculation of the truth. It is one of the duties of the ministry to instruct men in those truths of which they were before ignorant. If you have false teaching, you have no foundation to stand on. Your direction will drift off. And so, It is important to maintain the truth and teach the truth. Finally, in Colossians 1:29, Paul says, "For this I toil, struggling with all his energy that he powerfully works in within me." All the things we talked about, all the persecution, all the things about Paul, his zeal to teach God the gospel, his zeal to present every man blameless. All of that is done because God gives him the energy to do it and the power to do it. Paul pulls no punches. He keeps the goal in sight, and to this end, I strenuously contend. The word he uses, translated contend or struggle, is associated with the ancient Greek Olympics. Do you guys know what Greco-Roman wrestling is? It's not the stuff you see on TV. It is an Olympic sport. It's been in the Olympics for many, many years. What makes it different than a lot of other wrestling is you can only grab the other person's upper body. You're wrestling hard to try to be able to get control of the other guy and throw him down onto the mat. All upper body strength and power in your legs to stay up. But it is the most tiring type of wrestling you can do. My brother and I used to wrestle all the time. In fact, the eighth grade I wrestled. Only lost two matches my entire career to the same guy every time. But it is a grueling, hard thing on your body. And when you get done with a match, you are completely tired. But Paul says he struggles with all, struggling with all his energy, with Christ's energy, which powerfully works within him. In 1 Corinthians 15:10, it says this: "But by the grace of God, I am what I am, and his grace toward me was not in vain. On the contrary, I worked harder than any of them, though it is not I, but the grace of God that works within me." Are we allowing the grace of God to work in us? Allowing the grace of God to fuel us when we need it. In verse 58, it says, "Therefore, my beloved brethren, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that in the Lord your labor is not in vain." I read these verses and I get convicted. Am I being steadfast, immovable? Am I abounding in the work of the Lord? Do I really believe that the ministry we have, the gospel we preach, the Jesus we follow, do I really know that my labor is in vain? I mean, is not in vain. Each one of us needs to continually examine themselves. I think one of the things I like about the four elders is that whenever we are struggling with something, we can go to one of them. We can confess our sins. We can talk issues through. We can help each other stay walking on the true path and every one of us needs a brother or a sister that can hold us accountable. Next time, we're going to look at what are Paul's struggles when he's writing with the Colossians, to the Colossians. Let's pray. Father, we are thankful that you provide us with all that we need, all the energy that we need to contend with the evils of this world. Help us not to try to do it on our own, but help us to learn how to struggle, how to contend, how to fight to the very last, that we would serve you unconditionally, and that we would follow you unconditionally. We thank you for your Son that you gave us so that we can have an ever to everlasting life with you. So this next week and the weeks that follow, help us to search out the truth in Scripture so that we are following the true Jesus. Amen.
Stand as we sing.
Grace, this Jesus, my Redeemer.
Amen. Thank you, Grady. I pray that would be true of us this week, that we would proclaim him, admonishing and teaching everyone. We have a few minutes to spend some time encouraging each other and greeting each other. The equipping classes will begin at 11 o'clock then. Information about all of those in the bulletin, where what ones they are and where they are, so you can check there. Enjoy a few minutes of fellowshipping together.